Some people, a lot of coal plants have been stopped around the country
right.
because of capital reasons, some because of environmental opposition. And as you've acknowledged, there is climate risk for investors. Do you think that you're fully acknowledging or disclosing the coal risk of potentially future legislation, a price on carbon, that coal is really maybe a little more risky than even you're acknowledging or that some utilities are acknowledging?
Let me give you 2 points. One is a macro point and one is a company specific. The macro point is this. We have 300,000 megawatts of coal in the United States. 100,000 megawatts of it is over 40 years old and has never been retrofitted for sulfur dioxide, nitrogen oxide, or mercury. In my judgment, those plants should be shut down and will be shut down over the next decade. And so that's going to give us an opportunity to replace those plants mm-hmm. and really reduce the carbon footprint from coal in the United States. At the same time, and this is kind of on a micro perspective, we're building 2 coal plants, the only company in the country that is, but they are advanced technologies. In Indiana, we're building a co-gasification plant, which will be the cleanest coal plant in the world in terms of major pollutants, as well as the carbon intensity of the electricity. We're building a supercritical plant in North Carolina, which also is much more efficient, reduces our emissions footprint of all the pollutants, including CO2. But here's the most important point in the punchline. We're building these plants, but we're gonna, and they total roughly 1,400 megawatts, and we're gonna end up shutting down about 2,000 megawatts of these old 40, 50, 60-year-old plants who have never been retrofitted for SOx, NOx, and mercury. And so at the end of the day, we've started down the road of modernizing our plants in anticipation of regulations that will generally force us to close the plants. Starting early, I started my career as a consumer advocate fighting rate increases in utility companies, so I have a little bit of that perspective.
Interesting.
I'm still protecting the consumers. Maybe better than I did then, but by starting early on this modernization, we're able to smooth the cost impact out on consumers as we go forward. And it's very critical for us to have job one for me is providing affordable, reliable, clean electricity 24/7. I don't have the luxury of just looking through the clean lens or the reliability lens are just the affordable lens, I have to balance. And so what we're really trying to do is smooth out the cost impact so it may, where our product continues to be affordable. Today, we're about 30% lower than the national average, and I want to continue to maintain that delta because that allows us to attract significant investment and jobs to our states.
And some people would say the reason that Duke and other Southern utilities are cheaper than the national average is that the full cost of coal, the externalities, the carbon, is not built into the price. That you get to dump it for free in the atmosphere. What would you say about that?
Well, let me take North Carolina and South Carolina. 50% of our electricity comes from nuclear. So, and 50% comes from coal and hydro, and we're the second largest operator of private hydro in the United States. So when you look at the carbon intensity of each kilowatt hour, I'd say we're one of the lowest in the country, and by virtue of having built those nuclear plants back in the 60s and 70s.
And the hydro, which is all right.
And the hydro. Mm-hmm. I mean, so when you look at that mix in the Carolinas, I would put us up against any other part of the country in terms of the carbon footprint per kilowatt hour. Now, it's a different story in the Midwest, that part of our business, because that's predominantly where coal is produced.
Sure.
And we built most of those plants either on the Ohio River, so we had the advantage of the barge trade, or Monmouth in Indiana. And those are very low-cost plants. But the specific answer to your question is, yes, there is a cost. And as I build new plants, I factor in the cost of carbon. Even though we don't have regulations yet, I look in the distance, and I know we'll have regulations of carbon in the country sometime in the future.
There will be a price on carbon. What price level do you model?
I model anywhere between $15 and $50.
Per ton, per metric ton of carbon emitted.
Okay. Right.
So you think that there'll be a price on carbon, and you'd rather get ahead of it rather than get caught short later when it comes down, if and when
yeah.
it comes down.
Let me make an important point. In Washington, the political leadership there is focused on 2, 4, 6.
Years, yeah.
Years. 2 years for congressmen, 4 years for the president, 6 years for senators. I have to be focused on 40 years, 50 years, and 60 years. And as a consequence of that, I have to look beyond the short term. And even if I find an environment, as I do today in this Congress, that they're not going to pass any legislation, I think the world changes. I looked at the world in 2010 versus 2008 and look at the changes that occurred then. I don't know what's going to change in 2012. So I have to make judgments, and I have to hopefully help mold and shape energy and environmental policy, but I have to make judgments based on what I think the world will be in the next 10, 20, 30 years.